I'm Kevin Bieksa, and you're watching Nasty Knuckles.
You're listening to Nasty Knuckles, the Hockey Outlaws podcast, with your host, Derek Nasty Settlemyre, and former Philadelphia Flyer enforcer, Riley Cote, as they go behind the scenes with your favorite NHL players. Time to face off.
All right, welcome back. What's happening?
What's up, Nasty? How are you?
Doing all right?
Oh, I'm doing great. Just waking you up, trying to get you going here for today.
Been jacked up since 4:30.
Have you? Monday morning, jacked up?
Oh, yeah. Big week.
Were you?
Oh, yeah.
You banging went on the that. Eel skin bongos or whatever they're called?
We don't do eel skin quite yet.
I didn't know.
Maybe down the road.
Just doing some recording. Little
elk skin.
We got to let the drums wake, right? Like, you got to let them set.
Well, we did. We let that settle for 7 days.
Thank God. Thank God you did that, because the sound's not the same.
Well, skin's got to dry.
When you're primal, like, got to let it dry.
Got to let it dry now. You ever banged on a wet drum?
Oh, what? Sorry. Couple times.
You ever played a wet drum?
No? No.
It's not very fun.
Dude, as Baller and Devo messaged me, this is getting weird. That's what they both said. Like, Devo, he knows he said it too.
How's it weird?
How's it weird?
What,
you playing a drum? You got a full setup. I thought the fucking Black Crows were coming out for a fucking concert. The rug, letting the drums sit. Is it a drum or is it a bongo?
What is it? Is it a drum? It's a hand drum, yeah.
It's a hand drum. You need one of those Mr. Miyagi things.
Yeah, exactly.
The meditation drum. Yeah, the meditation drum.
Oh,
see?
Yeah. We'll have one of those too.
I can't believe that.
I got a fish drum.
What? When you go fishing? Yeah. You don't fish.
Well, it's called the fish drum. It's a Buddhist fish drum.
Oh, okay.
A little tappity tap.
Whew.
You need to hit the drum nest.
I don't want to hit them things, man.
No?
I don't know. I don't know. Anyway.
Stop hitting the bottle.
I need some bottle, I think, after looking at that. I don't know. I'm kidding, man. I love it. It's great.
Thanks. Appreciate the support.
I'll always support you no matter what. As weird as it can be, I will.
All right.
Except for the beard.
Well, I trimmed it, right?
And along here.
It's a little trimmed.
A little bit more on the side.
It was more trimmed than last week.
It is. It's more trim than last week.
Oh, yeah. It's trimmed last night.
You need to go to Tuna's guy and let him, like, really.
That's like a tight, tight fade. I don't know if I can rock that.
Yeah, you can rock it.
I don't have the style for that.
You have the style. All right.
I'll try it out.
Buddy.
What's going on around here?
Well, a little, I don't want to say meltdown, but we're not where we thought we would be. Another tough weekend for our boys here in the Black and Orange Flyers. Dropped a 4-2 decision to the Sabres, then came back the next day against the Blue Jackets. That was a tough game to watch, 6-2. Things just aren't going the right way right now. And it's coming down, obviously, with four games remaining. They've dropped down. Detroit's actually in that last spot. It's crazy.
It's hard. It's actually hard to believe.
Yeah.
Going this far into the season, playing the way they have.
Yeah.
Keeping that play high, the intensity high, compete high, and then going through a stretch like this at the most critical time of the season seems unlike them. But
yeah, it does. And you know, Baller was brought up the point. They're I believe since Coots was scratched, now obviously he was scratched two games, came back in, but since that happened, it seemed to, I don't know if the, I'm not blaming that, but they're 2-5-3 since. I know he came back in the lineup, and then he was hurt last week against the Islanders, and he's supposedly day-to-day. I'm not sure where he's at, you know, at this point, if he'll be playing tomorrow. Big game in Montreal again. You know, games you need, and then you have to go to the Rangers on Thursday, which obviously they're flying high. Obviously they're a great team. But, man, just disappointing weekend.
Yeah. Yeah, well, clearly disappointing weekend, and well, let's say the last, what, 5, 6, 7. So there's 7 in a row they've lost. So,
yeah.
And teams that needed to beat, right? I mean, especially this time of the season, obviously. However, you know, you look at it from a different perspective. These teams are, as we mentioned last week and the week before, they're playing spoiler. They're playing for jobs.
Yeah.
But nonetheless, at the end of the day, these guys got to find a way to get it done. So whatever has changed in the last few weeks, they don't look like the same team. They're losing games like they're not even in them. And that was never a thing before. So something's changed. I don't see the same team. And what a time to have a dip in the season. You know?
Yeah, and I think we said this last week, but the way they have to play is grueling and hard on their bodies. And then on the other side of that, like, they barely practice, even though, like, you know, we've heard Torch say we need to practice, but it's hard because these guys are worn out. And I'm not to say other teams aren't, because the Detroit Red Wings, the Pittsburgh Penguins, Washington Capitals, they're coming down the stretch just like we did here in Philadelphia with the Flyers. And, you know, I mean, it's actually blows my mind a little bit how long, and I mean, we're only still only that 1 point out, but like you said, we lost seven in a row, and to still just lost that spot.
Yeah, I know.
Yesterday, I believe, with Detroit's win. You know, you're right there. Detroit with 84 points, Pittsburgh with 83. They both have five games left. Flyers only have four, sitting at 83 points, and Washington has five games as well at 83 points. So, I mean, it's still up in the air. But man, like, we're gonna have to win out here, I think.
Well, that's it.
And you know, just it sucks when you're hoping for other teams and watching the other teams, but you know, coming down the stretch here, it looked like pretty much gonna get in, and not to say that we won't try to stay positive here, but man, it just hasn't looked the same, like you said, the last few weeks here, 2 weeks, I guess.
Yep. Yeah, I mean, all they can do is win these next four and hope at that point.
I mean, one at a time. That's so cliche.
One at a time.
But,
oh, yeah, exactly.
Exactly, but, yeah. I mean, and it's not like they can't. Yeah. They can do it.
I agree.
You know, it's just crazy to me that the way it's gone since that happened with Sean Couturier. I don't know. I'm not saying that's why they've gone. I mean, it could be a lot of things. We don't know. I honestly think, and Baller brought this up the other day, we were talking, and, you know, I wonder if TK's fully healthy. And a lot of guys aren't fully healthy at this time of the year. I get that. But, like, I wonder about that. And then losing Cootes again, say what you like about Cootes. I think he's a huge part of this team.
Oh, of course, yeah.
I still don't – I didn't understand the scratching of him. And I think hearing a little bit of things going on that a lot of guys didn't really think that was a great move. But in saying that, you still have to show up to play. And you got to try to get these wins, so – see what happens here tomorrow night. Huge game, one at a time.
Oh, yeah. Talk about crunch time. Oof. I mean, it was crunch time last week, but here we are.
I do enjoy when it's this tight and you know, every game means something, you know, for the most part, for at least five of these teams.
Yeah, so on
to
the
try
Easter
to get that
insane,
last spot.
Actually,
the West looks like it's done. Yeah. St. Louis fell way behind. So, but anyway, got to pull up our boots here and get a win tomorrow night.
That's it.
It's all you can do.
It's all you can do. Do it all over again.
Yeah.
Three more times after that.
Yeah, for sure.
And really wanted to talk about that brawl last week, Nast.
How nice was that?
Whew. Didn't expect. Well, I shouldn't say. I expected the one fight. Didn't expect the whole crew going on.
It was funny because you thought it would obviously just be Rempe going at it with Curtis McDermott. But I mean, it was everyone. And then when the three were going, the other two said, well, we might as well do it. And everyone was sitting down, though. Like, they didn't enjoy it.
Wow, who likes fights?
But you know what I loved the best was TNT. They were showing their reaction to it. Hank, Ace, they were going crazy in the studio. Like, Hank, you know, like, so don't give me this shit. That stuff's not important. That wasn't... Was it staged? You could say it's staged, but there was a reason that whole thing even started. And then the rest of the players that were out there, some of them who aren't known they're fighting. It's a team thing, man, and they stood up for one another, and that's awesome. to me. Mm-hmm. That's hockey. That's what hockey's about. I know you're not going to have that happen a whole lot, but to see it, I don't think it was bad for the league. That's for sure, because that was on every post. And, you know, you're going to get some people saying, oh, it's ridiculous, it's good. Nah, no, that was awesome. That was awesome.
I agree. You know, I guess you could say playing devil's advocate on it. Like, I believe that could have been avoided for the people that want to hate on the stage fighting and fighting right out of the gate. Had Rempe, you know, the main, you know, true, the main character in it, dealt with his behavior and actions the game before.
Right.
Right. So he runs Bastion's game one. He gets a match.
Yep.
They go and trade for Curtis McDermott, yeah, right? I mean, they go get him specifically to deal with him. I understand Rempe was very active that week, 2 weeks, right? I mean, right, it was like one of those things. But I believe, as active as you are at that moment in the season, you still have to answer the bell from a division rival that you blew up one of their players the week before.
Right.
Right? I mean, I think, anyways, maybe that's just me. You answer the bell there, it cleans everything up. So he not only doesn't answer the bell, he goes and pulverizes whoever yeah, that was, I forget what his name was, the European guy there, I believe, and elbows him, right? He gets three games. So then he doesn't deal with that one, blows up another guy. So now he's got two guys, yeah, you know, on essentially, you know, on laying on the ice and out of the game. So like, now this game comes, game three.
It's going to happen.
Well, yeah, I mean, yeah, you know, it's going to happen. You know, it's like, you can imagine the dialogue going on before the game. It's like, well,
now let me ask you this. As a former tough guy, it was a little different back then, because if you did something, you're probably going to have to answer for it that game, like you said, which he did not. But do you think Rempe, knowing this game's getting played the night before, is like, shit, I wish I would have just got it taken care of it then, because now I got to sleep all night, I got to think about it, I got to think about it all day the next day. We've talked about this with other tough guys, like, it's that anxiety that's hard. You think he's probably thinking that, or is like, who knows what the kid's really thinking in his head, but...
Well, I think it's like, those ones are almost like, I don't want to say easier, because it's like, there's 100% guarantee you're fighting.
Right.
There's no way out of that
one. Oh, okay. So you know what I mean?
Well, it's still anxiety for sure, because you know you're fighting a legitimate tough guy.
Yeah.
But I think like that whole, like, how is this going to play out? You know, is it going to be in the first shift, second shift? Like, you know, that's happening in the first
You'd
shift.
Rather have it first shift.
Oh,
right?
Yeah. You just get it. And you don't know, like, I mean, he don't know he's starting the game.
Right.
You know what I mean? Until they start McDermott.
Well, that's
and whatever
what I was getting
else, right?
For people that don't understand what happens is, when you're the visiting team, you give your lineup first.
Right.
And that's when, you know, so I'm
Labby
sure
matched
Labby
lineup.
Was like, all right, I wonder if Labby pulled him and said, do you want to, because I feel like you said before, Labby said, don't worry about this guy, just play. And we talked about that, and you thought, you could see Labby saying that to him because of how busy he had been and all.
Maybe
that
at
shit.
That point, but like in this specific game, like if Labby don't play or
if
start Rempe, something tells me McDermott might be do something stupid. He might grab whoever's on the line.
Like
just
Keith used to say,
just to send that message, be like, guess what? You call up this big tough guy from the minor leagues. He's gonna go and blow up our guys and not answer the bell. Well, guess what? Like you know what I mean?
It's like John Scott on Phil Kessel.
Really,
I mean, you know, things
and something and like that,
Chief
right?
Talked about he used to do that too.
Yeah,
like,
Brian Leach
told Brian Leach, "I'm gonna grab Zubov, or I'm gonna grab you, and I'm gonna pound you because of him,
because of Parrington, or whoever it was.
Yeah, it was Dale Parrington, exactly who it was.
So Labby had to match, the lineup and throw Rempe on the ice, and then you know, but you think it was just gonna be that fight,
right?
You're not gonna think that
no,
all five guys are gonna fight." But again, like bring this thing full circle. Obviously, there was a storyline to why the brawl happened. Most people are unaware of it,
right? True.
But I think like being having been, you know, a tough guy and being in that role, I would have dealt with things differently. I would have just cleaned it up. That second encounter with the Devils, fought McDermott, made that peace.
Yep.
Who knows if that other hit happens after the fact? That could be just a byproduct of playing hard, and you know, but he still elbowed the guy. But I just think that like it would have sizzled everything down there. But here we are.
Yeah,
you know, it's pretty, again. But is it good for like the game? I don't know. You have two camps, right?
Yeah.
I mean, but it certainly gets national attention. Everyone's talking about it. Rempe's in the highlights again.
Yes.
You know,
I don't think he's having to buy a dinner in New York City.
If he's going out to dinners,
I don't think he's buying any.
Definitely not.
A fan favorite. Give the kid credit, man. He stands in there. He takes them and gives them. And,
yeah.
You know, I enjoyed it.
Yeah.
Because it's so unexpected. Like you said, you probably expect the fireworks from those two, but for all five guys to, you know, or five on each side.
Yeah.
Just waiting on the goalies.
I know. No, just waiting for
chilling.
Just chilling. It's too early for a goalie brawl now.
Goalie brawl.
2 seconds in and you get dusted up.
No, that would be great. It was good TV. Yeah. I enjoyed it.
Probably a couple of years till you see that again.
Yeah.
If ever.
If you do.
Yeah. Anything else, Nast?
I'm not sure how we did in our men's league game. I actually couldn't play last night because
I was in bed.
Take care of Elvis. want to give a quick shout out to the Rebels kids that I work with in the North American Hockey League. Just fell short. Ended up with the same amount of points as the team that made it in. We just had one regular season win lower. So that's the first tiebreaker. Yeah, kids battle back. And, you know, a month ago, I think I had said to you, like, or 2 months ago, I don't think we have a shot. And then all of a sudden we go on a heater and the kids had a chance. And, you know, heartbreaker on Saturday we lost. But anyway, it was a great year. It was a lot of fun. I love those kids. Justin Hale and Matty Gaudreau do a great job with them. And it was fun. Sucks seeing the kids out upset, you know, losing. And tough to watch, but good group of kids.
Yeah.
It was fun.
It's great.
Year two.
Yeah.
The Rebs. So that's about it.
Regroup and get ready to rock.
Get ready to rock. Start training. For next year. You know?
I know how it goes.
You're making a comeback.
Oh,
you start training. As long as you got that drum in the locker room, you'll be ready to roll.
Oh, yeah. Changing the game.
Change the game, Debo.
All right, Nast. It's that time.
It is that time.
153.
Yes.
I got it. Kevin Bieksa.
Let's go.
Welcome back. I'm Riley Cote.
And I'm Derek Settlemyre. This week, got a little fanboy in me. Not going to lie. Yeah, this guy's one of my favorite players, and you knew that. This defenseman played 808 regular season games in the NHL, along with 86 more in the playoffs, Riggs.
Mm-hmm.
Most of those were the team that drafted him, which was the Vancouver Canucks, in the fifth round, 151st overall in the 2001 entry draft.
What a steal.
Yeah,
you're not kidding. And we talked about this last week about steals like that. You were definitely one of them. He's currently a member on the Hockey Night in Canada show. That he's a stud on there.
Yep.
I have to say that myself on the panel. Please welcome Kevin Bieksa, one of my favorite players. What's up, brother?
Not much. Thanks for having me on, guys. I appreciate it.
We appreciate your time, man. You got to be super busy with these playoffs coming up and everything you got going on. Rig said you were just in town, in the area,
just
coaching
Westchester, Philly area.
Westchester, Philly. Yeah, a couple of weeks ago, weeks ago we had the National High School Championship. So I started at prep school 3 years ago, not the school part, but I merged with the academic side and I started a hockey program. 3 years later, we made it to represent California, and we went there and we did pretty well. We didn't win, but that's kind of where Riley and I reconnected. I had one of my best defensemen get hit from behind first shift. So this poor kid, like, he's had the worst injuries, like a defenseman skill guy. He's been hit from behind like three times, like first time broken collarbone, second time injury, third time first shift of the game against Shattuck St. Mary's. Gets hit from behind. It's a penalty. They call 2 minutes. But he like rips a part of his groin off, doesn't play the rest of the tournament, which was sad for him. So I was trying to get him some PT and see if we could somehow salvage it, but he wasn't able to do it.
That's a shame. That's tough balance. First game, we said first couple minutes of the game, first shift.
It was first shift for the kid. So, and he was one of our better puck moving defensemen. So, so anyways, that's why I was in Philly. Had fun and had a Philly cheesesteak the right way. And it was delicious. But brought my wife with me, so a first time in Philly for her, and she loved it.
Oh, nice!
There you go.
Where'd you get your cheesesteak?
It was just in Westchester. I can't remember the name. It was recommended. I've been to South Philly though. I've had it the right way over the years. But and then actually I met with my buddy, who's the assistant coach for the Flyers, and got to catch up and shoot the breeze. And you know, I'm definitely watching the Flyers down the stretch here. I'm hoping they can kind of get into the playoffs, definitely over the Islanders and you know, even Pitt. Should I say Pittsburgh?
Yeah. Pittsburgh.
But yeah. I'm a big Torch fan, so I'm hoping the Flyers can get it together the last five games.
Yeah.
Expand on that, because we were going to bring that up. I mean, I know you played for Torts, I think, for at least the one season. There's the situation the Flyers are in, the East. I mean, there's a lot going on there.
Yeah, and I'm a huge Torts fan. I only had the 1 year with him. He signed a five-year deal, but after the 1 year, he just ended up letting him go, which I remember they brought a bunch of us in to the GM's office after the season. They asked us, like, what do you think of Torts? And I was one of the guys that definitely signed. Me and the Sedin signed off on him. Like, we love the guy. We want him back. Is he hard and demanding? Yeah. Does he call guys out in the media? Yeah. But, I mean, he's a guy that he tries to get the most out of you. And at times, maybe his methods are a little bit extreme, as you've seen in the last past week or so. But the goal is to get you to play your best hockey. So he was a tough coach, really tough training camps, the toughest. And just, you know, kept you accountable, though. And the good part was everybody was at the same level. It wasn't like star players could make 3, 4, 5 mistakes before they get called out. Fighters could, you know, not. It was everyone was at the same level. And I remember my favorite line was, you guys remember Tom Sestito played for the Flyers, too.
Yeah,
he
sure.
He would tell, he goes, Tommy, you'll go from 3 minutes a night to no minutes a night if you don't get that effing puck out of our end.
Oh,
so, everyone was at the same level. Best motivational speeches before a game, as you can imagine. So big Torts fan.
Yeah, no, I see a lot of the stuff you're talking about. I guess we talked about this a few times. Like, when does his strategy start working against them? And you talk about the media and like this last week or so, he's scratching Coots. I mean, going back, what was it, 12 games ago? Like, what are you seeing? Is this just like a Flyers team that's just exhausted, or is this like, is there some bit of a response to maybe some of his coaching strategy?
I don't know. Like, I can only speak from my personal experience. Like, he came out of the gate really hard with us and set the tone. And he called me out. I remember in Anaheim early in the season, because of the way I played a 3-on-2, and he really wants his defenseman to play 3-on-2s a certain way. And I didn't do that in Anaheim at the end of the second period. Perry goes through me, and then Getzlaf goes through my partner, backdoor tap in, and he comes in and loses his mind on me in the dressing room and yelling at me, screaming at me. First of all, he did it back in the coach's room, but you could hear, like, the walls were so thin. We could all, so me and like a couple of defense were looking at her like, who do you think he's mad at? Like, Amius is like, I think he's mad at me. And then Edler's like, no, I think he's mad at me. And I'm like, it could be me too. Like, we don't know. So after like listening to him yell in the coach's office for 5 minutes, he comes in, and sure enough, it was me. So he calls me out. It's fine. After the game, rips me again, you know, kind of blames the momentum of the game on me, which is fine. Rips me again a third time. So then finally, I'm like, okay, I got to go talk to this guy in his office. Like, enough's enough, right? Like, I play the game hard. Am I going to make mistakes? 100%. But like, don't question my character or how much I care. So I went into his office after a day off, and I had this big speech planned. And like, you know, when you're like shaking a little bit, like you're so emotional and you're like,
yeah,
I'm going to tell this guy exactly how I'm like, I'm a fifth rounder. I had to fight my way to get into this league and blah, blah, blah. I had this big speech, and he like sits there and he listens and he goes, can you swear on this podcast or no?
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
He goes, he's listening to me and he goes, Chiefs, I don't know what the fuck you're talking about, but I love it. I love how you're in here challenging me. And I don't remember that play. I don't remember. And I'm like, well, I remember, you know. And so anyways, like, I'm like, okay, this went okay. And then so we go into the room and he calls a team meeting and he calls in all the players and trainers. I'm like, oh my God, he's going to rip me now in front of the team, right, for coming into his office. And he just basically calls him and he goes, this guy just came into my office and just yelled at me and mother effed me. And I respect this guy. He's like, I don't agree with anything he said, but I respect this guy. And that's what we need more of. So. To your point about the Couturier, sometimes he's just looking for a challenge and he's looking for that. And then from there on end, he knew I was all in. He knew I cared and he knew I was trying out there, mistakes or not. And that's what he wants from his players. He wants them to be all in and care and try. And yeah, his methods sometimes are a little different, but they work most of the time.
Yeah, yeah, they do, for sure.
We've heard that about him a lot. Vinny LeCavalier was one of the first guys that we had a few years ago when I was still there. And he said, we had fuck you contests literally every day the last year and a half I was there. And he goes, now he's like one of my best friends, a guy I call, you know, because Vinny didn't have the easiest time here. And he was,
well, it doesn't like work for some guys. Right. As you said, some guys, it just doesn't work. Like I can remember one guy on our team, it just didn't work for him. He just didn't respond to that type of confrontation on a daily. So you got, he says first day, you got to have skin to play this game. You do have to have thick skin,
right,
to endure him over the course of the year. And some, the guys that do excel, the guys that don't, obviously they end up getting moved.
Right. Yeah. And do you think, like, I mean, obviously he does it, he said, for the challenge. Like he's expecting, or he wants you to confront him, right? Like he's going to push you hard enough till eventually you come into the coach's room and address it, or he's going to keep pushing you, right? I mean, for him to have a powwow after you come in there, like it's some sort of glorious thing, like shows like how much he actually loves that.
I think the door is always open for him. And I think he invites the dialogue. He obviously doesn't want guys always coming in and telling him to fuck off. Right. But I think it's a two-way street. He's not a dictator. It's like, let's talk about this kind of thing. Cause he's always like, well, how do you think the game? He's always interested on how other players, like, what are you thinking here? Why did you do that? So it is meant to make you better.
Yeah. No, for sure. And you'd like to think that, I mean, obviously he's, you know, one of the longest kicking coaches here still, and he's got some, you know, major successes along the way. So something he's doing is working. It's just like the shelf life lands up being short, and for obvious reasons. I mean, he's squeezing guys and he's putting the pressure on because he's trying to get the most out of these guys, and he's highly demanding. I just wonder, like, you know, you go this whole season this year, you know, like overachieving, getting guys to compete on the highest level, you know, bridging some gaps by just pure effort and buy-in, identity, and then like come to the, you know, the most critical time of the season, you know, where the schedule is in their Flyers' favor.
Actually, which,
you know,
in their
obviously a little
favor.
Bit of a psychology game there too, but you know, to have these games in the last, you know, seven in a row now, not even coming close besides maybe one of them. You know, I don't know what your thoughts are on some of these games, this fatigue or what.
Well, you said it, like the Flyers have overachieved for most of this season, right? And he's dragged that out of them, and they've become a playoff team halfway through the season. And then injuries, a player suspended, a pretty important player suspended, issues in net now. Like it's all kind of caught up with them, right? So, yeah, like, is it easier to endure them if you're winning 100%? If you're losing, it's a lot tougher to hear those video sessions and the critiquing. But it's still a Flyers team that if they make the playoffs, I think everybody would be happy with that, right? If I'm wrong, like, start of the season, I don't think playoffs were really in the mix. So say what you want, blame them, you know, give them credit. The Flyers are where they are because of him. And if they falter down the stretch, is he a perfect coach? No, he's not a perfect coach, right? Like his some of his things last week, like I just thought watching them from afar and knowing him really well, like, man, I wish he would have just maybe not after that loss attacked them. Like instead of just like you want to kind of almost be uneventful this time of the year and save that for after the season, right? Save like the callings, telling the guys, I don't know what we have here, the guys that can't play in the critical moments. Maybe save that for out. It's a great message, but maybe not the right time for it.
Yeah, right. I agree with that. Yeah, I agree with that. Yeah, they got their work cut out for them. You know, they just like watch it slip away the last seven games. So it'll be interesting. It's
amazing though. They've held on. Yeah, like with other teams losing, they're right there. Obviously, they only have four games left, and it'll be interesting down the stretch here. But in the West, there it's a lot different story. You know, basically you got everybody in. I don't think St. Louis is going to catch the Kings at this point. I know you probably have your eye on out West there a little bit more than out East, but with your job, you probably have to do both. So, what are your thoughts out there?
Well, I'm more familiar with out West for sure. And I go to Kings games. I go to a few Ducks games once in a while. I just think like everyone always asks, like, who do you like out of the West or who do you like to win the cup? And like, how do you pick? Right. Like, look at how Dallas just dismantled Colorado last night. Like, and Dallas for me was kind of like that team where before, like a month ago, I'm like, I'm not really scared of Dallas. You know, like, I don't know if they're the real deal. And that's when they were kind of lower in the standings, like third in the division. And now you're like, oh my God, what a powerhouse. Colorado is a powerhouse. Like, how do you say no to them? You know, you got the Oilers just buzzing right now. You got like the defending champ Vegas, and if Hurdle gets in the lineup, you can't count them out either. They're defending champs. It's tough to play in T-Mobile Arena. And then you have the Canucks who, you know, they've been pretty just steady all year, steady good team. And if their power play gets hot and Demko comes back, and like there's five teams I just named right there, right? Not to mention like the Kings, who knows what you have with the Kings. So it's a grind. Like you just look at, and then forget about that, like Nashville. Right, the hottest team since they didn't get to go to their concert. So, who knows? Right, pick your spots, pick your poison in the West.
Are you a Canucks fan? Even like, I mean, obviously that's you retired it one day. You know, contract there to retire as a Canuck because you played most of your career there. Are you kind of a Canucks guy?
Yeah, I'm a Canucks guy. I think I want them to do well. That's where I played the majority of my career. Am I sitting there watching every game and cheering for them? No, like I'm not like sitting there and, you know, live or die with a win or a loss, but I definitely am happy they're back in the finals. I still have a lot of friends in that organization and I want to see them do well. I think it's time, you know, since I left 2015, they've only made the playoffs one time. And that was that bubble year that for me doesn't even really count.
That's right.
They had like the play-in game and it was like a shortened 3 out of 5 series. So the fan base deserves a playoff run.
Right. Yeah. And I mean, they're sitting in first right now in the Pacific, second overall behind a hot Dallas team, right?
Like
you were just saying. What are your thoughts on Quinn Hughes, man? This guy, he's second on team in points with 86 and 77 games, and he's first among all D, man. He's pretty special talent.
Yeah. He's a stud. And he's the thing that getting to know him a little bit and just from some of the talks, he's a quiet assassin and people don't know that about him. Like they see this mild mannered, quiet kind of, you know, sheepish kid and kind of smiling ho-hum, but he's a killer. He's a wolf in sheep's clothing for sure. And he wants to, like when it's 3-0, he wants to make it 4-0 and he wants to make it 5. And he looks at guys at the other team. And I know this, and I haven't really talked about it because it would embarrass him, but he looks at guys in the other team and he says, that guy can't cover me. Like in on the blue line, like that guy can't cover me in the open ice. And he's a special player and he plays a ton of minutes for him. And he was challenged earlier in the season. If you want to play these big minutes, then your game has to be here. If it starts to drop here because you're tired and you're cheating the game on the defensive end, then your minutes are going to go down. And he's like, bring it, bring the challenge. Right. And his game hasn't dropped and he defends now. This season, that's the big difference for me is he plays well in all three zones this season. And that's because he decided he was going to challenge himself and be able to do that.
Yeah, no doubt. He is special. He's a good player. Obviously, Tocchet's done a hell of a job there. What a perfect fit for that group.
Yeah. Are you talking about in Van?
Yeah, yeah, Rick, Van, yeah. Yeah, Rick Tocchet.
Well, Tocchet and even Footer. Footer,
yeah, right.
Mm-hmm. And I don't know, like, I know Gonchar is there. I don't know how often he's there, but I know Footer very well. We've worked together before. But, yeah, like, just getting guys to play the right way. You know, sometimes you hear about all these coaches, and I don't mean to, like, come down. But, like, some of the new college coaches, like, oh, this guy knows the game inside and out. He's got all these systems and these fancy X's and O's. Well, sometimes it's just about playing the right way and managing the puck and getting the puck in deep and defending from the inside out and boxing guys out and recovering to the middle and all like the simple things that has worked for the last 50 years. And there's like different variations of a forecheck and a neutral zone, but really like you play the game the right way, like you're going to have success.
No doubt.
So it's just nice for them, the Canucks, to have success with all these highly, highly skilled guys by a couple of coaches that are just getting them to play the right way.
That's it. Yeah. Yeah. Again, like you say, Tocchet, Footer. I mean, you could throw Chief in that bucket. Like guys that played the game and not just played the game, but played the game with the intangibles that you're talking about, right? I mean, you can X and O all you want, but like you got to get a group of guys
compete,
to buy into compete, what you're saying.
Just compete. Compete. Right? Yeah. Compete and win your battles, your 50-50s, or win your net front, be a dog on a bone going to the net and not getting boxed out and get rebounds and goals like that. And if you watch the way they play, like they're not an overly big, especially their forwards, like Hoglander and Garland and Bluger. Like these are not massive guys. These are undersized guys and they just buzz around and they go to the net. JT Miller's not an overly huge guy. You would think he's 6'4" the way he plays.
Yeah, right.
Like, there are guys that Dakota Joshua is a big guy, but he never played like a big guy before. They've gotten him to play like a big guy, like a big power forward. So that's talk and footer for sure.
Yeah,
for sure.
Yeah, no, they got a good thing going on there.
Yeah,
it's been nice to see them
100%
figure that thing out.
Go ahead. I was just gonna ask. I was gonna say you grew up in Ontario there. I wonder if you were a Leafs fan growing up as a kid or a Sabres fan because you were kind of close there.
Yeah, we used to go to Sabres games with my brothers and my dad just because we were actually probably closer to the border to Buffalo and the old odd. And it was just, we go over there and my dad's a big guy, steel worker, you know. So we walk down the alleys and we'd scalp tickets, right? Like, didn't have a lot of money. So I remember walking with my dad down these alleys by the odd and just scary, scary dudes, right? With big trench coaches, and they'd open the trench coat up and it'd be like all these tickets. And my dad's like, we wouldn't bring my younger brother. He was too young. So it was my older brother and I. It'd be like three tickets. And then the negotiation would happen. And I'm like, oh, my God. It was so scary. And then you'd walk in and they're obviously the nosebleeds. And the old odd was so steep. It was like straight down. So I remember walking to your seat as a little kid. You're like, oh, my God, this is so scary. Like, is this going to hold? So that's what we went to watch was Buffalo. But I was actually a Detroit fan. We would get where I lived. We would get the Saturday night hockey night in Canada, Toronto or Detroit. And I was this big Steve Yzerman and big Bob Probert fan. Those were like obviously different types of players. But those were my guys. Konstantinov, big Vladimir Konstantinov fan for obvious reasons. So that's kind of who I cheered for growing up.
Nice.
Awesome. So what, I was going to ask you, when did you discover that you were tough? Like, so maybe you answered the question, scalping tickets on the streets of Buffalo, it generates some toughness there. But, you know, if you're following Bob Probert, obviously you had some toughness in you early. When did that kind of like creep out? Was it after college or did you already know you're tough?
It's not that I knew I was tough. It's just, this is just the way we grew up. Like my brothers and I, we were big wrestling fans. So back then, WWF, we would just wrestle and do all the moves on each other and just beat the wheels off of each other. And then my dad used to work for Stelco, which is the big steel company in Hamilton for like 15 years before he got into the union side. But they had a full contact company league. And it was sponsored by the company, and all the different departments and divisions would just grind and battle every year. So we would go watch these games in this old rink in Hamilton that doesn't even exist anymore. It was full contact. It was fighting. These guys would beat the wheels off each other. Then they would go to work the next day and they'd all work in the plant together. So I used to watch my dad's like 6'3". Now he's like 300 pounds. He was like 6'3", 250, like big, long ponytail, like mean looking dude, right? Defenseman. Used the shortest little tiny stick. He was like Wendell Clark,
Phil
right?
Wendell
Clark stick with a big like hook banana, and he was a D-man. He would just like kill guys, and he would fight guys. And I remember always having, he always had blood all over his beard from the guys he would fight. Like, short story, the one year they actually won the championship was a big deal for them. And there's 10 seconds left. They score an empty netter, so they're up two goals. They're gonna win, and 10 seconds left, puck, the other team wins it. They go D to D up to the centerman. My dad comes flying from the blue line, jumps up in the air, puts his shoulder into the guy's nose, and explodes the guy's nose. With like 10 seconds left, and they've already won. So I remember like brawl, he gets kicked out. My brother and I, we walk with him. We had to go down 15 flights of stairs to the dressing room. So we're walking beside my dad. Everyone's like yelling, spitting on him. This one lady throws one of those big garbage cans at my dad down the stairs. If it hits me or my brother, we're dead, because we were so little. We're like 4, 5, 6 years old. And anyways, like they're in the locker room. The guy comes down. He's like, "Al, what the hell was that?" He goes, "I'm sorry, I didn't mean to get you. I meant to get that fucking asshole right there." He drops his gloves and he starts walking like in the hall. Now he's trying to fight three guys in the hallway.
So that's what
I grew up with.
All right. That makes sense then. You get the Superman punch. Well, probably seen that a couple times, right? Yeah. Well, I get it now. It makes sense.
It's so funny. So we had Jack McIlhargey here as an assistant coach, Bucky. We called him Buck Diddy.
My first assistant coach in the NHL.
Yes. Oh, and awesome. So the funny thing is, obviously you attended Bowling Green 4 years, graduated with a degree in finance. Smart man.
Yeah.
But it was so funny because I had known Jack McIlhargey because my dad was his trainer when he spent time with the Flyers in his pro career. But anyway, Bucky, the boys loved him. Like, he was, Riles played for him too. And we called him Buck Diddy. But Bucky came out. I'll never forget. He came in. He's like, "You're going to like this, Bieksa. Nasty. He's your fucking kind of guy." And I'm like, "Oh, yeah." And he told me a story. I'd rather you tell it because I think I'd screw it up. But I guess when you went to your first pro camp, you may have gotten a little scuffle with a few guys or something. I can't remember exactly how it went, but he said, You're playing hard, playing tough, and then guys are like, "Who the fuck's this guy think he is?" And you ended up maybe knuckling it up a little bit.
Well, I remember the lockout year. Remember before we went to training camp, the season was already canceled. We already knew the NHL season was canceled. So I was in the AHL for 4 games the prior year after my college season, just a little cup of coffee at the end of the season. And I got into a fight with a teammate in the bar, and that's kind of been talked about too much. But anyway, so I go to training camp, and I'm penciled in to start the year in the East Coast League. They signed me to a 3-year deal, NHL, AHL, East Coast. And I go to camp, and I just play hard. And so we're doing, like, drills and stuff, like one-on-one full ices, and I'm following, like, Lee Gorin into the corner and finishing my hit on him after he shoots it. You know, he does a shot, a fadeaway on a one-on-one, and I follow him into the boards and just bury him, right? And he's good. He taps me on the shin pad. "Great job, kid." And I don't know, I was just kind of playing hard like that. So anyways, I ended up winning, you know, a spot on the team. I think I was the only guy that wasn't on an AHL deal that ended up making the team. And so that season obviously was Riley, you were in the AHL. It was the Wild Wild West, right? Like,
yeah.
I had 15 fights that year, and everybody, like, we had a tough team, and everybody had a tough team. And we had, like, 2 heavyweights. We had, like, Wade Brookbank and Jonathan Aiken. And then we had, like, bunch of middleweights, like Lee Gorin and me. And, like, we had a ton. Josh Green fought a little bit. Like, it was just a tough league that year. Yeah. So I don't know if he's probably talking about the Fedorov story, but a good Jack Mack story is when I finally get called up to Vancouver in the NHL, like, the next season. So we're in Colorado, and in between, before the game, Mark Crawford goes to the board, and he points at their fourth line, and it's Brad May, Bugner, and High Note. He goes, "Nobody fights these fucking idiots. No one fights these fucking idiots tonight. We're gonna beat these guys." So I'm like, "Okay, whatever." So first period, like, all 3 of them are asking me to fight, right? Like, I'm new guy up. I got, like, I think 1 or 2 fights already. You know, and I'm like, just kind of play my game, ignore them. Like, it's hard to say no, but I'm just trying not to, like, antagonize them a bit, but still play hard. And then anyways, like, we go out, start of the second period. We're lined up. I'm starting the period, and all 3 guys are starting. And they're like, they all take their turns. Brad May, Bieksa, "We're going right now." And I was like, "Can't." And then, like, High Note, we're going right now. I go, I just said no to him. I'm definitely saying no. He goes, "Bob Bugner, you don't have a choice. You're fighting one of us." And I'm like, Jesus Christ. Like, well, now what do I do? Right. So yeah. The puck drops, and I'm just standing there, and I'm expecting all 3 guys to run at me. Well, Heino takes the draw. He doesn't even take a, like, try to win it. He just drops the stuff and runs at me. So I fight Heino, right? So whatever, guys tap me on this, like, "Great job." So after the game, we're on the bus, and Mark Crawford, I walk by him and Jack McIlhargey, and he's talking loud enough so I can hear him. And you know, the rookies sit right at the front of the bus. Yeah. And he's like, "This effing guy, Bieksa, he fucking thinks he can do whatever he wants. And I'm going to send him right back down to the minors tomorrow." And he's saying all these things. And Jack Max just sitting there. He's like, "Well, I thought he played well. What are you talking about, Crow? Like, I thought he did a great job." And he's like, "Oh, I told him not to fight anybody." And Jack Max like, "You're mad at him because he fought?" And, like, Jack Max just didn't get it, right?
Yeah, right.
Like, he did a great job. He stuck up for a teammate or whatever. So that was Jack Max, right? Like, he always had my back my first year.
We had so many Bucky stories. He was just a treat, man. We had so much fun with
boys
him.
Boys love him. Hartnell used to just rip, like, half clappers on the ice across the ice, and, you know, before practice start, just right his hit speed. Hit his tuck and his little speed wobble, and Bucky's almost peeling over.
Yeah.
Just like, you know, bing, bang, boom. He's always firing boys up.
Wonder bar. You know, so it's like wonder bar.
I used to love it. I used to say, "Hey, Bucky, you ever sleep with a redhead?" "Not a fucking wink." So many Bucky stuff. Just a little time. He was a great guy, but he told me one of the first times I saw you play, he was like, "Yeah, fucking love this guy, Nasty." Speaking of your first year, the league was great, the American League, because there was no NHL that year. You had a you played 80 games that year, 39 points, 192 PIMs. Pretty good start for your really your first pro year. Not a bad year for you, man. And a good, really good really American good league. Probably the best it had ever been with the players that were playing. And I know we ended up winning it. We would have actually, you guys lost to Chicago in the playoffs, and we would have met up with you guys in the finals if you had not. But
so we had, I had Randy Carlyle that year, which was huge for me. Just to have an NHL caliber head coach and a defenseman who had played the game. Like, he taught me a lot of the little nuances and obviously, like, you know, put me in my place an awful lot, right? Like, how many NHL games you have, kid? Like, I heard that once a week and I'm like, none. It's the lockout. I have none.
Like, still working on that, coach.
I just came out of college, but he, and I remember the one time I talked back to him. It was at the end of the year. And like you said, I already had 39 points and it was in the playoffs, and I was starting to feel a little more confident, like, hey, I'm one of the guys, right? And I said something in a power play meeting, and he ripped me for a minute, just swearing at me and yelling at me and calling me every name in the book in front of all the power play guys, and my face is beat red. And so he kept me honest. But I remember when we went to Philly that year, it was like an 11 a.m. game, and we're playing at the old Spectrum.
There's
half the rink or whatever was full was all kids. It must've been like a school day.
It's school day.
And we had just bussed in from Cleveland, which was like a 6-hour bus ride the night before. So we get in at 3 a.m. We're playing at like 11. I'm like starting and I'm yawning on the starting lineup. As soon as the pucks drop, Josh Gratton and Mike Brown just start going.
I remember that. Yeah.
Oh. And I'm like, what? Like, how is this happening like this early in the morning? Like only in Philly, right?
Yeah, in Philly. Yeah, the crowd was going bonkers too. It was a good
kids,
fight too.
Like, it's just violent. Yeah,
right. Kids are like, kill them. And you're like, oh my God. Boys, can we ease into this game a little bit? Can I get a couple passes first?
You remember it's so funny you brought that up, because anyone that played in that game, anyone that we've spoken with is like, what were they doing? It's 11 a.m. And you can just hear just the flash.
Yeah.
Those two just pounding each other. But
I loved it.
Just two leather faces throwing knuckles at each other.
Yeah, exactly. Gratz was, we would always be like, he's like, he didn't even hit me. I'm like, bro, he hit you like 10 times. Pillows. Speaking of, Riles kind of brought it up a second ago with your pretty famous Superman punch. Man, you took down two of my really good buddies, man, Andy, Andreoff, and Goody at home. And the funny thing was, well, it was funny for you. Like, you caught Goody, and I remember being on the bench, and I'm like, in my head, I'm like, he's going to Superman him, because everyone talked about it all the time. It's such a great move. And so you did. You caught Goody. He goes right down. He leaves. So I'm taking his gloves back, and I go in, and Goody's down at the end of the, you know, he's sitting in his stall, and he starts shaking his head. He's kind of laughing. I said, you all right? And he goes, didn't see that one coming. And I said, Goody, you ever watch YouTube? Yeah, he started laughing. He goes, not enough, obviously. I was like,
it's funny. So he's in Anaheim now. So I've actually become, he rented my really good friend's house when he got here. So I met him at the start of this year. We went out for wine, and now we've become friends. Like, we golf together. I golf with him and his dad about a month ago.
Oh,
like, he's an unreal guy.
Oh, my God, the best guy he is.
He's the best guy. But, like I used to – I don't know about you, Riley, but I watched hockeyfights.com. Like, I had a scouting book on everybody. So, like, as much as I went into the fight and, hey, let's fight, like, I had an idea before I fought guys what their tendencies were. Like, I knew you were a lefty, Riley. Like, I knew Josh Grant just going to stand in there and go toe-to-toe. Like, I knew everybody's fighting style. Well, Gudas is not a fighter. Like, he's a hard-nosed top. Like, he's not a fighter. Andy Andreev, I love the guy as well. Yeah, he fights a ton, but is he, like, a fighter? No. Like, I knew with Gudas, I go, hey, I'm throwing coming in on this guy. Like, he's not going to expect it, right? Like, when I fought, like, you know, and even against, I fought Wayne Simmons, and I fought him twice, but I fought him once in Philly as well. Like, he's a fighter, right? And I threw coming in, but I threw with a little bit more, not respect, but maybe caution, right? And I was watching your fight against Roy, the guy in Tampa, Riley. You came in and you hit him with that, right? I started at the end of my career really throwing a lot coming in. And I learned that from Rick Rypien. And I never had that earlier in my career. I was more like, square off and get a good grab on a guy and control the fight that way. And then I watch this guy, and this guy comes from a boxing background. He is the best, smartest fighter and like most fearless fighter. He had great technique, but his technique was boxing technique. His technique was hang in the pocket and he would slip punches. So he would go toe to toe, but he was always moving his head. You never really saw him get hit clean. And that's why he was able to beat guys like Cam Jansen going toe to toe when he was a little guy. Like he was 5'10", 5'11", 180 pounds, right? So I learned a lot from this guy, even though he was younger than me. And then after that, like Tanner Glass and even Darcy Hordachuk, I'm like, I'm going to start throwing coming in more because what an advantage. So practice. Like I had my punching bag, the Bob thing, the MMA Bob thing with the no arms. I had that in the garage and I named it Dion Phaneuf and I'd practice it in my garage all the time. And hate to say it, but like the street fights I got into was the same thing. Like always throw coming in. And now it's a Superman punch. Now it's a left hook and you just kind of keep guys guessing. So it was a way to get an advantage off the bat. And when it worked, boy, it looked good. But even when it didn't work, it put the guy on defense right away, which is kind of the reason I would do it.
Yeah, I agree with that. That was kind of my strategy too. You're trying to get a couple licks in early. I was always trying to come in with, I try to come in with a left of some sort, but I understand your perspective on that because if it really works, it looks great. And then even if it doesn't, like you said, you get a couple shots in before he gets set, however it plays out. But
right away, the guy like is like, oh, he's throwing a punch and he's in protect mode, right?
Yeah.
Like I've never seen a guy and maybe we will one day, but I've never seen a guy when one guy's coming in to throw, the other guy's throwing at the same time.
That's right.
Like the Rocky Balboa, Apollo Creed, right?
Yeah.
You haven't seen that on the ice. And I know like guys try to emulate it and like Gabranson's tried it and Austin Watson's tried the Superman and the other guy's always on defense. He never throws at the same, like whose reaction would it be when a guy's throwing a punch at them to throw at the same time? Like nobody. So it's kind of a free shot.
Yeah. I guess the one fight comes to mind is probably it was before our era of actually playing pro. You probably remember this fight. It was Aaron Downey versus Jesse Bullerice. Do you remember that? Like, I mean, obviously it was a counter punch, but like, nonetheless, you talk about coming in with the bomb.
And Jesse normally did not do that. It was so actually out more of character patient than that.
I know. Him. He got excited, and then
he got excited, came flying in. And oof,
you don't see like you don't see that kind of stuff.
Is that often. Maybe like a time where Jesse was a tough guy? Maybe did he not respect Downey enough? I who knows? I'm not trying to put words into his mouth, but I remember the one guy that I got knocked out from was Tom Katsopoulos. I went into that fight. I'm like, he's tough, but like he's not
whoop his ass. Right,
that's what I thought in my head. And I went in and I could have hit him early and I didn't. I'm like, no, I'm going to like take my time with this one. Right. And he got me and dislocated my nose, closed my eye, knocked my tooth out with one shot.
I
didn't go down. Like I kind of, you know, when it hits you so clean that you don't even really feel it. It's just like a warm feeling. You get that warm.
Yeah.
And I kind of did like a half a squat and then I stood up and the linesman right away was in. He's like, go to the dressing room. I was like, really? Like, what do you mean? Goes, trust me. You go to the dressing room and the trainer's like on the table, like trying to put your nose back into. And I'm like, oh man, I was like, I should have won that fight if I was, maybe I didn't give him enough respect. So anyways, that happens sometimes, right?
It does. Yeah. And I'm not sure on Jesse on that one. Like Jesse had a karate background. Like there was a very disciplined martial arts. And he's normally very patient with that kind of stuff. That's why I thought it was out of character, but you know how it goes. I can't remember the situation of that fight, like the timeliness of it, but maybe he just was excited and thought he had a pocket there to bomb him. I don't know, but it happens.
You're not going to win every fight. You're not going to win every fight. And like you tell me, you might disagree with me, Riley, but like I like to get hit every once in a while in a fight. Like, don't get me wrong. Like I wanted to win every fight. Like that was the most important thing, was to win for my team. But like, I kind of wanted to get hit in the fight a little bit. Like nothing, like I didn't want my nose broken all the time and my eyes closed, but I don't know. Like, are we a little bit twisted that way where you like, you kind of want to get hit once in a while?
Yeah, maybe. Cause I was kind of the same way. I mean, is it nice to go in, you know, guns a-blazing and, you know, 1-2 punch guys? Like, you know, it looks great on the highlight, but like, yeah, I say some of my best fights are the ones I'm just like in there just eating punches while I'm throwing and just like, you know, it's just old school. It's just,
Yeah. It's like badge of honor. Like I would go to the Montessori school to pick up my kids from Montessori sometimes. I'd have the shiner.
Yeah.
And I'm like, you kind of feel like, hey, like I'm a warrior, right? Like that's who I am. I earn my money. I earn my living. So I don't know, like that's maybe a little twisted side of us.
Yeah. No, I think that's part of it, right? I mean, you're not really ever in a fight until you get hit, right? I mean, you're not a fighter unless you kind of welcome that piece of it. Otherwise, you know, you're some bit of a snowflake, I would think, right? I mean, it's always easy to say you're a fighter when you're winning and, you know, you one punch a guy. But I think the challenge is when you start getting hit, how do you respond to that? But yeah, who wants to get their nose blown up? But like, it's part of it, I guess. You know, if you're going to fight 100, 200 times in your career, you're going to get your nose broken. It's just nature of the beast.
Yeah. And it kind of, the reason I was, you gave us a great explanation of how you grew up and it makes sense now why you were such a hard nosed player. But we had Nick Seeler, who's a D-man with the Flyers. And I kind of like, I'm not saying he's as tough as you, but he's a pretty tough kid and he's unassuming. He played in college as well. And that's where that was kind of why I asked about, you know, you played 4 years in college and everyone's wearing a cage. Everybody's tough, right? Like probably in college, but then you prove it, you step into the big time and you prove it. And Nick Seeler's had some pretty good tilts here. You know, it took him longer to get to the NHL, but he's a pretty tough guy.
I like his game a lot. And I know like he was in the trade rumors a lot this year because everybody wanted him and he had a really good favorable contract, but he plays the game the right way and he's tough. And the thing about college, and like this is obviously the podcast to talk about this, like everyone's like, oh, like there's no fighting in college. Like I fought 15 times my last year in junior. Like I played tier two. I fought like 8 times my second year as a 17-year-old, so I had a fighting hockey fighting background. Like summer hockey, like I fought Kyle Hagel in summer hockey, who fought 25 times a year in the AHL, right? Like, like I grew up in Hamilton, right? And Port Dalhousie, like there was fights. But in college, like I got in, and I hate to admit this, but it's also like the right place for it. Like I got into fights in college in like street fights with bouncers trying to help get like some of my teammates in. And you know what I mean? And bouncers wouldn't like some of my teammates, or they get in trouble because they're trying to, you know, wheel a girl and another guy didn't like it. So, you know, a couple fights off the ice, maybe that definitely prepared me for pro hockey.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For sure.
We had the right attitude watching WWE. And, that whole world going, you know, getting some tickets on the streets of Buffalo. I'll toughen you up. And in Hamilton's, I mean, it's, well, you lived in the Peg too. I think Hamilton's much like the Peg. I grew up in Winnipeg. So, I mean, it's like, you know, the tough cities, man. Like you got to have some bit of thick skin, you know, and get out of these cities.
There's always somebody tougher too. That's the thing, right? Like I didn't grow up like winning all my fights. Like there's tough guys everywhere. Everywhere you look, like you go to a high school party when you're in grade 9 and there's like these 12th and 11th graders just beating up everyone. And you're like, oh my God. This is how we grew up. Like kids luckily now don't have to grow up like that. But that's kind of the reason why a lot of people in our era like fought so much, right? Like it's funny, I was having I golfed with Steve Thomas the other day and played in a different era. He retired in 2004, so I just missed him, and we're sitting around and he had a 20-year career, but I remember him as a goal scorer, like playing with on Matt Sundin's line in Toronto, playing in Chicago with Denny Savard. And I look at him, I go, how many times did you fight in your career? And he looks at me and he's thinking, he goes, 100. And I go, what, 100? I go, you were a goal scorer. He goes, yeah, 100. So I look it up, and sure enough, he was 100. Like I was only 85 in pro. I think like 60 or 65 in the NHL. This guy's at 100, and he was a skill guy. But that was the way the game was played back then. Like everybody, you go into Philly, you're probably fighting somebody. That was the way it was.
That's right.
It's true.
Different animal back then.
Yeah.
Yeah, we've had a bunch of old school guys on. It's just like the stories and just the attitude, the energy going into games was different. It was just you see, you're going to war. I mean, you're coming to Philly, you expect the battle.
Yeah,
no question.
We were talking about this earlier. What did you think about the Rangers Devils the other night? That you've been in that situation, obviously. Actually, you were a centerman for a couple minutes there. But what did you think about that?
Well, just snapped it back, right? You can't forget about the face off when those lines are all.
That's right. That's right.
Somebody's got to win the draw.
You're winning the face off. Westgaard's grabbing you, right? It's like you want that puck back.
Priorities, right? Priorities. Yeah. We can get to the fighting. I don't know. Like I'm sitting back. Obviously, I was in Vegas actually watching the U16 Nationals when that happened, and it was everywhere on the TVs in Vegas and all the casinos afterwards. I mean, there's some people that don't like it, but there's the majority of hockey fans that are super entertained by a line brawl. And fighting is up this year in general. And you know, it was tapered for a while, and this is a bigger discussion, but I just think fighting is like a representation of passion. So when there's fighting, it's because there's not as many tough guys anymore. There's not as many designated fighters. Like, you know, the Rempes, the Reeves, there's some of those guys still, the McDermotts, but their fighting is up this year because everyone is just playing with so much passion. I think that that's when the game is at its best. When, yeah, there's a ton of skill now. There's a ton of speed. The game's never been faster and more skilled. But the last couple of years prior, like, nobody wants to watch all these guys skate around and do skill moves and just not finish their checks and break a sweat. Like, I want to see skill and speed amongst other guys trying to hit them and trying to slow them down. Yeah. And I think that passion has really gotten up in the last, this year especially. And that's why you see all the fighting. And this Rempe kid, like, much like us, he comes into the league and he's just trying to stay in the league. Yeah. And yeah, his first game, he fought Matt Martin, asked him, like, you're 6'7", guys are going to ask you to fight, whether you're tough or not. So he says yes to Matt Martin. And what a feeling to fight in front of everybody at MetLife.
Wow.
And then, you know, like, now guys want him a little bit. He runs around, he throws hits because he's trying to stay in the league. And he only plays like 5-6 minutes a night. He's trying to make the most of his minutes and bring energy. So, you know, he throws the hit at Bastion, and yeah, you know, now McDermott's asking him, like, I don't know. I think the whole thing was handled the right way by everybody, by McDermott, by him, by the line mates saying, hey, like, we're fighting, like, Jacob Trouba and Keandre Miller are two of their, besides Fox, that's their two best D, and they're right in the war with them. Like, yeah, that's what they, that tells you what they think of Rempe. Right? We have your back. And then the guys on the Jersey side, Marino, and the guys that have nothing to do with Rempe hitting, you know, they're in the battle too. They're like, yeah, McDermott, you're fighting. We're right with you. So I don't know. I love that stuff, obviously.
Yeah, no doubt. What were your thoughts on like the second game that the Rangers played the Devils after the Devils had acquired McDermott related to the hit on Bastion? Like Rempe should have probably just dealt with it then, right? I mean, I know he's very active. I think he had fought in like every game. Yeah, so I understand maybe Lavi's telling him to pump the brakes, but like, you know, I'm just thinking, like, I was talking to Nasty before. I'm like, fuck, I'm like, I would have just dealt with that because clearly, you know, they went and traded for this guy to deal with me. And, you know, and, you know, just you drop the gloves, you dust it up, and then it kind of kills it, but, you know, obviously didn't. And then he runs over whoever that was and blows him up in 3-game suspension. You talk about like building a storyline. Oh, obviously MSG. Here we go. Five on five. Right, it's like, this
well,
thing
that's the
up.
Thing. Like if he fights McDermott right away, it does squash it. By him not fighting McDermott, it kind of leaves open McDermott and some of the Devils guys to maybe do something to Fox and Panarin and those guys. So
that was
a little bit risky, but from his perspective and from the Rangers perspective, like, you're going to go and trade for a heavyweight to fight our guy. Like, we're going to make you wait. Like, we're going to make you on our terms. Right. Like, or maybe his hand was busted up. Cause you're right. You fought Delorier, fought, who else did
Olivier.
He fight?
Reeves at that point.
Olivier.
Right. Yeah.
So maybe his hand's busted up and he needed another week or something like that. But I don't mind it. Just from their perspective, like, hey, I'll fight you, but like, it's going to be on my terms, right? Like,
that's a great,
you're not going to like, and McDermott was so like riled up. He was ready to go and everything.
Yeah.
So it almost like served his purpose. Right. And then he's the kid's clearly not afraid. Like, you see him like, hey, let's do this when it was the right time. So
yeah,
I don't mind that. I don't mind that from the Rangers perspective.
Yeah, I agree. And I think, you know, knowing Lavi, it was probably coached a little bit, you know, just probably to exactly what you're talking about. He's like, listen, like, let's do this our way, you know, like let it come to you, however that plays out. And then obviously, you know, game three, the Devils are starting McDermott and these other guys, like Lavi could easily not have, line Rempe up there. But then to your point, you know, does McDermott just grab whoever just because, like, here we go, So
in our line brawl is the same thing. Like, and that's why I wasn't sure why Laviolette was so mad afterwards at Travis Green, because the home team gets the opportunity to pick their lineup after. So for ours, like in Calgary, they were starting McGrattan and Westgarth. And Torts comes into the dressing room before, and he's like, this idiot, Hartley, I don't like this guy. He's a loser. He's starting his idiots. He's like, well, I got to start ours. I can't. So it's not like Hartley's totally to blame, right? Like, he's like, I can't put the Sedins out there. I just can't do it. So, Sestito, you're going. And Dale Weiss, you're going. Yeah. And I'm like, can I go, coach? Yeah, you're going. Garrison, you're going. So, it's funny because the home team can defuse it, but you're right. Then it's a ticking time bomb, and it's just inevitable, right? So you might as well just meet it straight on, and you see everybody smiling and laughing and high-fiving on the penalty box. It's a galvanizing moment for sure for both teams.
Yeah,
I agree. Yeah, because if it went the other way and he starts anybody else but those guys, like, and then something happens, like you get demonized, you get crucified for not throwing your tough guys out. And then all of a sudden it's like the other side is like, oh, full on brawl. And then you're going to get, you get ripped on for why would you throw those guys? You know, of course, like
it's John Scott when John Scott two-handed for Kessel.
Exactly.
That's exactly right.
Yeah.
Craig Berube's good friend of ours. And he's told us a few stories where I think it was Dale Puritan was running around and he went over to Leach. Brian Leach is the captain of the Rangers. He says, hey, you better tell him to settle the fuck down or I'm going to grab you or Zubov and I'm going to beat the fucking brakes off of you right here. And he says, Leach goes, hey, fuck off. tells Puritan to fucking knock it off, man.
Yeah, but was that not a tactic you used, Riley? Like, I use that line all the time. Like, always. The Swedes would make me go to Cronwell before every game and warm up at the red line. And they loved him, but they're like, this guy can hurt people with his hands.
Yep.
And I would go to Cronwell every game and I would say, hey, you know, like all those hits, like not tonight, like don't do it tonight. Like, and he goes, what do you mean? What do you mean? I go, you know what I mean? I go, I've never been suspended. I've never been fined. I go, I have a lot of people behind me that will take care of me. I go, I will hurt you. He's like, oh, Kev, I'm not saying that you did, but I'm saying if you throw one of those hits, like I will get you tonight. And he never did, luckily, right? So the Swedes are like, just say something to him, Juice. Just make sure he doesn't hit us like he hits him. I'll try, but keep your head up.
Oh, man, yeah. Yeah, that goes a long way, right? I mean, it's like the whole accountability piece, I don't think most people realize how powerful that element is, right? Because, yeah, some guys will still cross the line knowing that the other team has somebody that they have to deal with, but like, I could remember, like, you know, expecting to fight George Laroque, and all of a sudden George Laroque's not in the lineup. He's like, oh, well, now I can run around even more than I was going to run around anyways. You know what I mean? And that energy that I can, you know, bring is even beyond anything that I would have already brought because of that. So it's like, you know, getting someone's face in their ear a little bit, it does deter some poor behavior at times, at least.
Yeah.
And Nasty's seen a few of those
games. Yeah. Yeah, I saw a few of them.
Yeah, right. you mentioned just kind of shifting gears here a little bit. I think it's an important piece to talk about, you know, the mental health crisis that we're in. You talked about your boy, Rick Rypien. It's hard to believe it's, you know, been, what, 13 years, 2011, I believe. Yeah. Can you talk about Rick a little bit and, you know, obviously your relationship with him and how important, like, the work you do? And you know, I believe that you were, like, the first teammate that he had confided in, you know, when he was going through his struggles, just the importance of being vulnerable and speaking your heart and asking for help.
Yeah. I mean, it's just one of those things where like you can look at someone who's the toughest guy physically and on the ice. And then you don't know what's going on in his personal life and in his head. So we were driving to training camp when he first confided in me and saying like, I almost didn't come back this year. And I remember thinking like, we were young guys. We played in the NHL together. We got called up at the same time together. We were now like, we're in the NHL playing out our goals, like our dreams of our life that we've worked so hard for. I couldn't fathom, like, how are you feeling like this? What do you mean? Like, what do you mean you didn't come back? We've been working for this for our whole lives. Like, we're like, let's enjoy it now, right? We're at the top. That kind of made me worry a little bit. And then we just kept talking. I could just see he was struggling off the ice and struggling with some of these things. You know, I didn't do anything special. Like, I just listened. And absence, and then me and Craig Heisinger, who you guys know, we went and got him after one game in were playing Edmonton, and it was in a snowstorm. And after the game, Zinger and I rented a car, and we drove. No, we flew to Lethbridge, and then we drove from Lethbridge to Curtis. And we didn't know because Rick wasn't answering his phone anymore. And we basically, like, we made a plan. Like, we got to get this guy to come back to Vancouver because that's the only way we can help him. And we're like, well, what if he doesn't want to come? And we, like, had this plan where, like, Zinger was going to distract him and I was going to, like, choke him out from behind, and then we're going to drag him into the car.
Oh, jeez.
And I'm like, let's think about this one, Zinger. So you think I'm going to be able to choke him out? And, like, so when do I stop? Like, and then he's like, no, but, like, let's just, like, kind of, like, physically get him in the car. I'm like, I don't think this is the weird thing. So anyways, luckily we were able to talk him into coming back. And And then he was in the program, and he tried to get help, and he had a lot of support from the team, from all of his teammates. Everybody, like, nobody knew what was going on with him when he was taking his leave of absences, but they were all asking me, like, is he okay? Is he okay? Like, everybody wanted to help. Like, the city, Edler, all these guys wanted to help him out, and everyone was super supportive. And it was one of those things where just he couldn't overcome it. And in the summer, he took his life, and you know, he loved being around the guys, and he loved him, and that was like his safe haven. But when he was on his own, he couldn't handle some of these thoughts. So, you know, following in his legacy, just trying to, you know, do what I can to build awareness so something like this doesn't happen again. And obviously it's going to happen, but if you can help one out of 100 people, then all this was worth it. And all the awareness and starting Hockey Talks, and mindcheck.ca was the original website that we kind of relaunched, getting kids that were struggling and adolescents that were struggling with some of these feelings and thoughts to go online, fill out a self-awareness survey, and then we can kind of like direct them towards the proper channels, whether it's a doctor, a therapist, somebody to talk to. The first stage is always when someone you know, starts to kind of open up to you, it's your responsibility to be that ear for them and allow them to get that burden off. You don't have to give advice. You definitely don't have to pass judgment. But if you're that person with your friend or family that they open up to, you have to be that ear for them, that outlet for them. So that's what I tried to be for Rick. That's what I'm trying to get, build the, you know, the message and the awareness across the board that mental health, they're themed about it. It's not a weakness, it's a sickness. So if you're struggling inside, you don't have to internalize it and think, oh, I'm soft. Oh, I'm mentally weak. Like, that was always the stigma. And that's why a lot of these kids don't end up asking. So we're trying to destigmatize it. Like, everyone in the community that's been, like, Michael Landsberg's been a huge advocate. Yeah. The Canucks have been huge. The rest of the league has jumped on board. Destigmatize it. If you're having mental illness, get help, right? If you have, like, a knee injury, you get help. If you have, like, a shoulder, you get help. So this is the same kind of thing. Kids don't have to die. Ask for help, and there's a lot of people out there that will help.
Yeah, exactly. No, that's great advice. Yeah, because it's, I think that's the hardest part, is asking for help, because there is that dark cloud in society where, you know, it is a toughness, it is a show, you know, we think it's a sign of weakness. And that's why I'm in the same camp as you are, is like, if you're feeling like this, you have to ask for help, because no one knows. Like, you know, like, so many people do a great job at appearing like everything's okay until it's not, right? I mean, I recently lost Chris Simon here, right? And I think everyone had kind of been knowing he'd been struggling, but like, God, like, you know, maybe get a, again, this is more complicated than just like, you know, one-off situations of like, you know, just struggling in general. Mental health is more complicated than just like, you know, one specific event. It's generally deep-seated and maybe some childhood trauma, and then you're mixing in substance abuse, and, you know, in these cases, probably head trauma, right? I mean, fighting is probably not the best thing for mental health, but like, I'm not sure that this is a fighting issue. You know, it's much deeper than that. And, you know, guys are struggling, not even just hockey and sports. I mean, this is way beyond sport. I think it's just, we just highlight some of these situations. And,
well, the thing is, like, if there was nothing we could do about it, like, sharing or confiding in somebody would kind of be useless, but there's things that can help now, right? Like, if it's CTE, concussion based, like, there's some great doctors out there. Like, Dr. Stefan Sigalad is a guy in Vancouver. Anytime I had my bed, I would go see him. He would rearrange my dura in my head, and I would sleep like a baby, and I'd feel that clarity the next day. I wouldn't have that fogginess. So did that help me in my career? Like, probably a ton, right? There's like that and naturopaths and chiropractors, But there's also, like, there's medication in the right situation also helps to balance you if you have severe anxiety, depression. Sometimes just taking a pill will help. And I'm not advocating for medication for everyone, but for some people, like for my wife, for instance, you know, it's changed her life. It's balanced her out. So there's a lot, like maybe some people just need to talk to a therapist and have somebody talk them through their thoughts. There's methods that work. So that's the reason why I encourage people to ask for help, because you could be helped. You could be helped saved, right? Some situations it's not going to work, but there's some kids that could definitely get the help.
Yeah. Absolutely. That's super important, because I mean, I do a lot of work in youth hockey, and I see this, like, the beginning of the dark clouds presenting themselves, and it's, you know, a combination of a lot of things, but maybe pressure from the parents, you know, pressure from the coaches, and then obviously the pressure we put on ourselves, unrealistic pressures, and you know, and the competition and the ego in it all, right? I mean, it's almost like it's probably unhealthier now than it's ever been, right? Youth sports, it's just like, it's wild. And it's just like, so the more we can talk about this and at least present some solutions, the biggest one is just ask for help when you're struggling. But it's a problem. It's not going away.
I'm working with a junior team now. I've been away from the Flyers now for what's been 3 years now, but I work with a junior team, and I'm even with the Flyers, I'm known as a little bit of a prankster. but I gotta say, dude, when you were the security guy, I've probably watched that. That's one of my favorite things ever. I want to do something like that, but dude, get the mole, it just everything, and it's got the so wand. Boys are like, fucking Getsy's like, what the fuck's going on here? How much fun was that for you, man?
That was a lot of fun. The year before that, they made me be the stick boy or the shovel boy,
ice crew, right?
It was the first preseason game of the season, so like most of the young guys were playing. So I did that, and that was fun. And then the next year, like, we got to do it again. But the only person that knew was Bob Murray, the GM, and me, and the one lady that worked for the team. No, none of the players knew. They're like, okay, the guys come to the rink at 4 o'clock, you know, in Anaheim, down the ramp there, and come in their nice cars and their suits. They're like, can you come for 1 o'clock for makeup? I'm like, what? I'm not coming at 1 o'clock and then staying till 10 at night, because I'm not even playing. So anyways, I did end up going, and like 2 hours of makeup to put the mole on and the nose and all that stuff. And it was a lot of fun. They didn't show some of the other stuff, but I got most of the guys pretty good.
Yeah, it was classic.
It was hilarious, man.
I don't think anybody really knew, because they all went back into the dressing room after, and they're like, who's that security guy? Like, what a loser that guy is. Like, they were all talking about me. That's how I knew I got them. And some of them didn't know until after the game, which was
no
amazing.
Way. Oh, that's awesome. God.
After the game, I came in, and I said something to Cam Fowler, and he goes, that was you? And he goes, because I was like patting his quads. I'm like, wow, you got big legs. You got big, strong legs. You must be a good skater.
You imagine the boys just, oh, what man. The fuck's happening?
And I go to Cassie's a Czech guy, and I go, what are you, Czech or something? Or no, I go, what are you, Russian? He goes, Czech. I go, same thing. Yeah. I'm like, Czechs and Russians, like, don't want to be called. Yeah. So,
we had his brother here. That's right. Yeah. His brother played here a little bit.
That's right. Yeah. So that was fun. Those jokes are always fun, right? Those are always fun to do with the boys.
It was awesome. I also want to throw out a quick shout out to a couple equipment guys, since I was an equipment guy. You had a couple legends, man. You had Sluggo, right? And Anaheim, and obviously Pat O'Neill, who's just a fucking legend as well.
Yeah, a lot of games between those two guys, right? Yeah. And Sluggo, I remember when Sluggo, we got him a boat for his retirement, and big fisherman. Cool. But it's funny, I remember Randy Carlyle coming to, like, a few of us, like the leadership group, and they're like, calls us into his office before practice. He goes, what are you guys getting Sluggo for his retirement? And I'm like, what? He goes, yeah, like, he's retiring at the end of the season. And I'm like, well, I think, like, we have, like, a watch or something he's going to get. He goes, no, you guys are going to get him a boat. Like, what? What do you mean a boat? He goes, you're going to get him a boat, and you're going to roll it onto the ice. I go, okay. So, like, hey, team meeting, boys, we got a little collection here. We got to get Sluggo a boat. And every guy's like, we're getting him a boat? So, like, he deserved it, obviously, but it was funny. Like, it's kind of pushed onto us. Hey, you're getting him a boat, and you're going to, like, wheel it onto the ice. So we did it, and he loved it. And
yeah.
What, What a beauty. Like, one of the best things is going into the back room with the trainers and just shooting the breeze. And that's something I always love. Like, whenever you're kind of like, you know, you're at the rink and you're in a bad mood, you just got yelled at or you got bad video, just go back and hang out with the trainers for a bit. They'll put you in a good mood.
I miss that the most.
Patty O'Neill is the best in red. And those guys, like, I just love sitting in their back little room on their high chairs there and just shooting the breeze with them and grabbing, like, whatever on the road, you're like in Chicago, you're like, where are the trainers? I'm going to go find them for a beer. Yeah. And just want to hang out with the trainers. Great guys.
Yeah, I miss that more than anything. Ryle's probably spent most of his time in my office.
Yeah, I did. I think I spent more time in Nasty's office than I did in the locker room or the video room for sure.
We had Hitch. Well, my first full season as the head guy, Hitch was our coach, but he didn't make it too long. It was about 9-10 games, but he used to walk by and be like, what are you guys doing in here? I had like 10 of the guys literally sitting on the floor in my office and a couple in the hallway. And we were just laughing and shooting shit. And here comes Hitch down the hallway. What the fuck's going on? Get out of here. Yeah. I was like, fuck off.
Hitch. Holding court.
There's so many Hitch stories over the years, right? I can't even tell some of them that I've heard from players that I've played for them.
Yeah.
I think I know some of them. You probably
there's a couple.
To,
Yeah.
Yeah.
Man. What a beauty he was.
Juice, man, we can't thank you enough for your time, man. I know you're a busy man. I've been really looking forward to this one since Ryle's told me, but thank you so much, man.
I had a lot of fun, boys. Appreciate it. Keep up the good work.
Yeah, thanks. You too. Yeah, you do a hell of a job on TV there. So
really good.
Great representation of the game. Keep it up.
Thanks, buddy. Thanks, boys.
All right, big thank you to our friend Kevin Bieksa hopping on.
Awesome. Beauty. Awesome guy. Yeah. Loved him as a player, which I said 10 times, but
yeah. Yeah, he would have been a perfect flyer.
Oh my god, he would have.
Tough as nails, obviously.
Yep.
Superman punching guys. Don't see that very often.
Yeah. Coming at you.
Hey. Why not?
Why not? Worked.
Made it look easy.
Sure did, man. You know what I was thinking about? Him, one of your best fights didn't last long was your one punch on Wah. But like, I wonder if you come flying in like that, he comes in with a Superman if you both go down.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because what if he, like, think about that. Like, every time he did it in those fights, he's throwing the right, but a left was a guy. You guys could have hit a fist, too.
We could have.
You could have. Because you're a big lefty. You never did the Superman. You should try men's league. Do the Superman in men's league.
Yeah. You know, it takes a lot of balls.
It does. Because you can get caught with one.
You can get caught.
I don't think you're expecting it.
I don't think so. You got to make sure, you know, you're landing properly. Landing on your feet. But
I know what you mean.
The punch, too. Yeah. I mean, you're kind of all in on those types of plays. That's kind of coming in with the bomb, right? I mean, you better hope you land it because you could throw yourself off. But
you're right.
It was well executed. Give him
very well
full
executed.
Props.
100%.
Full props. It's tough that guy. Time, Nast.
Let's go. Is it that time?
Whew.
Time for the
KK.
Clear questions.
Oh, yeah.
Brought to you by Clear Rum. Go to clearrum.com/shop. Type in Nasty2023 for your code, and you get 35% off on your order in PA only.
Oh, yeah.
But you got to get it in
you. You got to get it in you. You know it. It's that time. Let's go.
Do it, baller.
Starting us off here, we got a message over on Instagram from Sal Raffa.
All right.
He asks,
Soosh,
who was the most entertaining player or staff on the road or unpacking equipment?
Well, I mean, Seuss, you put yourself out there now. Videos are coming because I've got a million of the Seuss man in action. He was always entertaining. B-Rad was right there with him. But Sal was probably, we would get overtired and just do dumb shit and giggle and laugh at 3 a.m. when no one really wanted to be there.
I saw mommy kissing Santa Claus underneath the mistletoe last night.
Dumb shit started happening, and Baller, I will flood you with videos for this one. Sal, sorry you asked for it. One of my favorite moments was him
in the bag.
Well, that was good. He was really good at that because he's like, I'm a small guy. He's a little shorter than me. We took
Are you sure?
Yes, because
I want to see that. It's true. Head to head.
But I will tell you this: we always stood together in team pictures, and as soon as the guy would go one, two, and I go tip those, and I push him down. He would get so fucking mad. I looked like I was like this much taller. But yeah, Sal, we had so much fun. We worked together with the Phantoms. Obviously, he was there the year we won the Calder Cup the second time. But Sal was awesome. We had so much fun, and boy, he hated Snapchat at 3 a.m. because I just had I was blowing him up. Oh yeah. Sal, you asked for it, so the vids are coming. There's a few coming.
Sal is awesome. A lot of fun. Always being silly and goofing off.
Yeah.
Keeping guys light. What was the story with him, and was it Fridgy with the coffee? Was he a pop-up?
Oh, man. I think we told that one time when Fridge was on, but yeah, like, so I got him in the bag, and the boys are coming in off the, you guys were coming in off the bus. We were in Maine, and I think it was a Sunday. It was 3-3. It might have been 3-3, and Fridge, you guys are coming in with your coffee. So I'm like, hey, Fridgy, you know, like, he's a good guy, right? Yeah. He'll help me. I'm like, hey, this bag's heavy. It's laundry. Can you give me a hand with it? Oh, yeah. Goes down. Fuck, Sal comes out. Fridge jumps. Hot coffee right on fucking Sush. He was. I'm never doing it again. Oh, man. I'm never doing it again. Yeah, Fridgy threw the hot coffee on him. Not cool. Yeah.
Prank gone bad.
Prank gone bad.
Hot coffee
for
the
Sush, it went bad. No, I didn't get burnt.
No.
Sal did. But anyway.
Sorry, Sal.
Yeah.
Appreciate you.
Yep.
Hope you're well.
We got Super Dino Mike over on Twitter. Whew. He asked, do players get to go to Sixers, Eagles, Phillies game for free?
Sometimes they do, yeah. For the most part, I remember we used to, even me, like, well, guys would get the tickets, but for me, I'm a basketball guy, and I got to go a few times. Even I think we went together one time with Richie. Did Richie take us, and we split it up? But, yeah, we used to... You guys used to get tickets on the floor, Mr. Snyder's seats there. And I know guys still go to games. They get those floor seats. Mm-hmm. Eagles, yeah. If it worked out for the team, we got tickets.
Yeah.
For anything, really.
Yeah.
Lucky, very lucky with things like that concerts. Our boy Jeff Gordon.
Oh, yeah.
At Live Nation always still takes care of the boys and has been great to me. And I know you as well.
Yeah.
And our boy Malcolm.
Oh, yeah, Malcolm. Yep. Yeah, the perks of playing in big cities, I guess.
It's nice. It is nice. I mean, very, very fortunate for that. Never take that for granted, for sure.
Yeah, it was always a blessing. And always different people trying to help and share their boxes and whatever else with the boys. So the courtside tickets weren't always up for grabs for not just any guy on the team.
That's right.
You have to be patient, get the tap.
Yeah. You got to get the tap for that.
Yeah. So great question.
Yeah, it is a good question.
Bunk one. Over on Twitter asked, what was it like having Chris Pronger on the team?
Prong daddy.
Bonksy. Foo. Big Foo. He was great, man. One of my favorite things ever. Every morning when he walked in, Huggy.
Oh, yeah.
Huggy would be waiting on him, eh? Every day. And Prongs would walk in, and he'd be like, morning, Chris. Prongs. Fuck you, Snuggles. Right away in the morning. Just kidding. Just obviously, he loved Huggy.
Yeah.
Prongs was awesome, man. You talk about a guy that, Riles, you could talk on it. He didn't care who you were. If you weren't doing something right, including himself, he would say it. And
you'd hear about it.
You would hear about it, and I mean anyone, from veterans that were on the team to, you know, even
Richard. Staff, probably, too.
Luckily, he never yelled at me. No.
Maybe some of his stuff, right?
I tricked him. We talked about that. He never knew it. Well, until I told him, tricked him on his gear. But, he was awesome. That's a great question. That guy, talk about a just pro. Everything he did was, I mean, the way you would want your whole team to do, right? Like, it's hard to get, you know, 24 guys to come prepared the way Prongs did. But he showed up every day, literally every day for every practice, every game. You didn't have to worry about that with him.
Yeah, and he was obviously one of those last few, like, real old school guys.
Man. He could have had a penalty called on him every shift, every night. I never seen a guy, I think we said this too before, where the refs were, I think they were afraid of him.
Oh, I'm sure.
I've never seen a guy speak to referees the way Prongs got away with. Like, totally. It was crazy.
Because it was Prongs.
And he would just, he would, like, two hand a guy, break their arm and be like, yo, he hit me.
Yeah.
You know, like, it was unreal.
Yeah, I always liked Prongs. You know, he's one of the early guys at the rink. So
Rigatoni, spent a lot of time. That's Rigatoni, where Rigatoni came
Prong
from.
Daddy, you are the originator of Rigatoni. So story goes, I mean, Nast. I think you came up with Riggs, right?
Riggs,
and then Riggs sort of slowly became Riggedy.
Riggedy Riles.
I think maybe Ray Emery threw up, you know, something in there too.
Yeah.
And then Prong Daddy comes around, and obviously Riggs turns into Rigatoni.
Rigatoni. Every day.
You hear him yell it down the hallway. Rigatoni. Yeah, so apparently I'm still Rigatoni.
Yeah. Prongs was awesome, though. That's a great question. That guy was he was amazing. God, he talk about a first pass out of the D-zone. Oh, yeah. Like, this guy, it was tape to tape.
Oh, yeah, crispy.
Oh, my God. Like, he was so
good. You weren't ready for that thing blew up right
off. Oh, I'd break my stick if I tried to take that pass. But what there's a reason he's a Hall of Famer.
Yeah.
I mean, unbelievable player, unbelievable leader, great guy. I loved him.
Yeah, Prong Daddy, hope you're well.
Yeah, man.
We got one more. This one's from Swoop70 Ken Murray over on Twitter. And he wants to know, do you roll torts back?
What was the question?
Do you roll a fatty when you... Oh, no.
Do you roll torts back? Do you bring them back next year?
Woo. Loaded question.
Wow.
I guess we'll see how these next four games
go. Yeah,
I would like to think up until the last seven games, he was up for Jack Adams.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't think he would have got it. I'd probably talk. But, but I think his name is definitely in the bucket. So, you know, and then this happens. So I think it all depends on it. If they can squeeze in, I think he's definitely back.
Yeah.
But, I mean, an epic crumble, I'm not sure. I mean, it could be up in the air. I mean, some speculation there, but.
Yeah, we've heard a lot of different things, but that he wanted to go maybe to go upstairs after this year. I don't know if that's true. We've heard that. I'm just saying we've heard that. I'm not saying that's a fact. We've heard it. That's a great question, though, because, oh, man, I don't know.
I think, like, the timing of the question is tough because they're in the middle of a crumble.
Yeah.
And if they can manage to salvage this, I mean, I think this conversation is different than if these next four games continue to crumble.
Yeah.
I think the dialogue is certainly different around him and the season, unfortunately. So. Yeah. Maybe revisit that one.
Yeah. That's a really good question and a tough one, like you said, at this point in time, because, you know, 2 weeks ago you would have said, Hell yeah. So I guess we'll see. Great question.
Yeah, that's a great question. That's a wrap.
That's it.
You got four great questions there.
Those were great questions.
But that's a wrap for 153.
All right.
In the books.
Next week. 154.
Huh. Can you believe it?
No.
I still can't. How could you?
No, right?
All right. Be sure to subscribe, like, comment. Great questions. Keep them coming. So until next week, stay safe, knuckleheads.
See ya.